have been talking back and forth so far about entry summary or customs form 7501, CBP form 7501, and now we get to the point where we are ready to discuss how to really fill in those blanks. What goes in? What goes in into this, into this, into this? Some of the fill in the blanks on this form are pretty much self-explanatory. Some of them require more deliberation, more thinking. They require your knowledge of law, of regulation. One example is the time of entry, or entry date, which we covered to quite an extent. And we know that entry date varies depending on what you submit, on how you submit, on mode of arrival, etc., etc. And we know that the duty rates, for example, they may depend on the entry date, or they may depend, for example, on IT date, depending if you enter something for immediate transportation. So, what, in other words, this is more than just a form. This is really one box can open you up to the world of questions which require your knowledge of laws and regulations. Some of them are not so clear cut. And over the years, customs has been recognizing this, because the way they started out, the way this whole process of CBP entry summary, CBP 475 started out, is they used to be covered under section 141, I believe 60 somethings, and also a little bit to some extent 142 something. And then a lot of rules were prescribed there. Then with time, customs have adopted what they call instructions. Instructions to CBP form 7501, where they sort of clarify. And here in instructions, they go beyond, they can restate all those rules, all those laws that are provided in those sections, but they also go beyond that. They sometimes give you the precise definition of what to fill in. Sometimes they built upon these regulations. And over the years, this has been growing and growing and growing, which is most of the merchandise coming into the country. You have to say, okay, what type of product is it? Is it quota product? Does it require a visa? If it is a quota type, then you enter two. Sometimes you have combinations, so you have quota, visa, anti-dumping duty combination. We haven't discussed to the great extent about anti-dumping, but it's a special type of duties that are assessed on merchandise which is being dumped on the United States market. So if you have both, then you need to assign a different code. Then you have a different type of entry. So the goal here is to match up the entry. Straightforward stuff. A particular section as being the column. So if you have, so for example, in the case of 27, it would refer to this as being a column. It's just a label or phrase, but just be mindful. Sometimes they refer to as blocks, sometimes they're being referred to as columns. So we have a Canadian company which sells a shipment, a footwear shipment, to United States company. But before they arrive by truck to this port in North Dakota, so North Dakota is in the United States, they find a buyer to another shipment. So you kind of have to picture the United States and Canada. So this is North Dakota somewhere, and So the merchandise hits the border. And before it arrives, before it gets a chance to arrive, the new buyer is located in Denmark. So Denmark is in Europe, so it needs to be shipped to Denmark. So what happens? The shipment is transported by air out of Chicago. So Chicago, so we have Great Lake somewhere here. We have Port of Chicago. So the shipment goes to the Port of Chicago and flies out to Denmark. So really, this is an incorrect arrow. So this is what happens. So this is Canada. This is US. And they are asking, customs examiners are asking you advice on how this should be imported. Anti-dumping duties will usually have a case number assigned. And the case number will be, have to be structured in a certain way, where you have A, which stands for anti-dumping, or C, which stands for countervailing. And you will have number, general number here, and specific number here. And that specific number will usually apply to whom? It will apply to particular exporter who qualifies for higher or lower rate. Identification number, which is located somewhere towards the upper middle. And the identification number is really fill in the blank for the blocks 22 and 23 for the consignee and the importer number. So you have a first time, so let's say you opened up your own brokerage. You got your license, you passed your exam, you set up your shop, and you have a first time importer coming in. They say, I'd like to import something. And the very first thing you do, besides doing power of attorney, besides making an agreement, besides arranging your own diligence with customs, such as filing for the port permit and advising of the employees if you have any, you also need to tell customs that this particular importer will be bringing products through your port. And the way you do that is you do that by filling in the number, but that number by itself is not enough. First of all, this number must come from, must be reported to customs on a separate form. Visa construction, the second and third digits are ISO country codes, right? And here you have this number and the second, so you have V for visa, first number is 3, so I assume 2003, for example. And the second and third is ET. I think it's Eritrea, right? An African country. So ET is the country version. That's the way it has to be for this line item, at least. So this one, you look at ET here, and you pick the answer A.